lecture. I thought this was still part of the conference. I'm not sure whether it is, but at least I hope we can spend some nice time. I was once in following a course in Harvard Business School, and they have the same classrooms as what you have here, with four levels, one, two, three, four levels of desks. And the professor was explaining the psychology of the people who choose to sit on the first, second, third, and fourth desk. Now, the people on the front desk, they of course like to, you know, to be seen. The people on the second and third, they are at eye level. You know, you're at eye level with me. But the people on the very back, they're the people that have something to hide that the teacher cannot see. And he quoted, he had George Bush, you remember, one of the American presidents, as a student, and he was always sitting on the very right on the black lane. And then they're very active, you know, they walk through the audience and so on, so that everybody can see what he did. And he was checking, and actually he was having this chewing tobacco. I don't know how you call it, you know what I mean, but you have it in Russia, you have this tobacco, the sailors at sea, they used to eat this, and he was eating this. It's a dreadful business. Anyway, we're not talking about that. We're talking about two things, really. One is innovation in education, in teaching. But I will not give all kind of theory, but just an example of something that I have been involved in, that I hope will be maybe giving you some ideas. Now, the thing I have been involved in was a course in entrepreneurship. We want to have more students who start their own company. There's something interesting going on. Just a second. That's how it works. Yes. Yeah, there we are. And we call this course Ready to Start Up, but it's just a name. It aims at students who are seriously committed, not considering, but committed to start their own company. And we have many of them. I think in 20, 25 years that we've been doing this, well, we didn't count, but there must be over 100 companies. And, one was sold actually for 400 million euro. And that is 40 billion rubles, right? So it's it's a lot of money. And the boy was just 35 years old, and he has all this money in the bank. It's very funny. And he's still a nice guy. So that is the techno-start. We call them techno-starters because I'm from a technical university, and we support boys and girls who want to start their own company, but only if it is based on a technical principle, on new technology. If they want to start a new taxi company, we'll say that's fine, you must try it definitely, but not with us. We're a technical university. Oh. Here we are. Now, techno starters, I think in principle everyone can be an entrepreneur, but not everyone realizes this. So later I will show you, we have a whole program at the university for entrepreneurship, so that this course is not just one on the list that you can take, but it is a step in the direction of a very basic introduction into entrepreneurship to actually doing it. It has to do with skills, and it has a lot to do with perseverance. You can't say, it might be a nice idea, but next week, maybe I should try something else. No, that's not how it is. You have to be very dedicated, I must say, all these students are very passionate about their subject. We always think, and this is what you read in the journals, that they start a company in order to become rich. Well, there are people who have become rich, but very few. It's like football. You know, footballers who get salaries and income of millions of dollars, but it does not mean that if you start playing football tomorrow, that you will get the same income. You know, that it's a pyramid. I don't need to tell economists. No, the students do it for fun. And they have an idea, and they're passionate about it. And that's why it's very nice to work with them. I like to work with passionate people. I do something wrong. So, how do we do it? Well, we don't lecture. So for me, as a professor there, it was a very nice experience, because if I ask them, what do you want me to do, they would say, don't do too much. And I stick to that. The workshops were given by experts from advisory companies. So for instance, if you want to set up a company, you need to know something about marketing. Marketing is very central in business, because it is the way you position yourself against the market, let us say, opposite the market. You have to understand the market. If you don't understand the market, yeah, you can still sell a product, but then you're very lucky. You really have to understand the market. And also, you have to know how to approach the market. So it's all in marketing. Now, we have professors in marketing. They have studied the subject and written about it, but the people from a practical firm who sort of do this marketing advising every day, they are more useful in this course than the academic people. Now, the same we had accounting was given by, you have to know how to do accounting if you want to have your own company, and how to make a balance sheet and so on. It was done by an expert from Ernst & Young. Financing was done by an expert from a bank. And this way, I'm sure later we had a whole group. So, in other words, the subjects were not done by university staff, but by people from industry. And this is now a principle that came up also this morning, and it comes up again and again. It's why should there be such a big separation between the university and industry? You know, we train students, they are 100% of their time at the university, then they get their diploma, and hop, they're 100% in industry and no longer in university. We have people like yourselves, your lecturer or whatever, in a university. You maybe, I'm exaggerating, but you've never seen a company, and you have people in industry, and they have not seen a university since they graduated. I think if there's more overlap, it is beneficial. It could very well be that academic staff have advisory functions in industry, or they do little odd jobs. It's also helpful to earn some extra money, but is also mainly, I would say, to stay up to date, to know what is going on. And likewise, you can ask teachers to come and at least teach at these practical courses, because they have state-of-the-art knowledge, and for them it is again attractive to see what is going on with students, because students now they are very different from what they were 20 years ago. Not to mention even earlier. So this is changing very rapidly. And it's important for them to know. It's also important for them to get to know students, because they also have to recruit. So there's always a recruiting element in this sort of collaboration as well. So the aspects of entrepreneurship are done by the experts from industry. And we have a number of these clubs, as I mentioned, there's a Young and a Marketing Bureau and a Rabobank. And we have a foundation. They're all members of this foundation. They put a bit of money in the foundation, and twice a year we go out for a nice dinner, and we discuss the next course and what we need to change and so on. So you can say it's a group of people who are very motivated. We all do it free of charge, and we have a lot of fun together, and we have a lot of fun with the students. So here are the workshops.
So they have a number of workshops. We do it on Wednesday afternoons. And, well, they sit like this. Here are the subjects. I hope you can see it. And, yes, of course you can see it, because we have two screens. And if you like it, we can send you this presentation. If you give me an email address, I will send it with pleasure. 11 workshops. It's very important part is that they learn how to present the company. Now you can say to present the company is not an academic subject, but yeah, why not? I think it's an increasingly complicated world and a world that is less standardized, and then it becomes very important also for lecturers like yourself to be able to present yourself in a proper way. And that comes across. In the old days, you would say, this lady has a diploma in, what do you call it, specialist in economics. So what more do I need to know? That's all I need to know. And now, these diplomas have so many aspects they want to talk about it. So they have to learn how to present the company, not only for clients, but also for financiers, because usually you need money and you get it from people who are willing to invest. So, basically all students can participate, but also we have had once a member of staff who said, can I do this course? I have very good ideas, if you're most welcome. So it is, yeah, very regular. How do they get in? Not everybody gets in, because I'm getting these people from industry, and I can't confront them with a couple of students who are stupid and not motivated really to start their own company. If I would do that, they would feel they're wasting their time and they won't come again. So we have a very strict selection process in which they have to convince us that they're serious of starting their own company. If the students say, yeah, we think it's a very interesting idea and we think it's a very nice course, they're absolutely without a chance to come in. And many have already a prototype of a product that they want to use for the company. Yeah, they bring their own subject, of course. We can't say we match you with the subject. But we do now, yeah, we do two classes a year, between 20 and 30 students in each class. There are always some that drop out. After three or four times, they say, oh, we were completely wrong. This is not what we, that can happen. So they drop out. It also means that the ones who complete the course, they almost always pass the exam. Well, actually, they don't have to pass an exam because they don't have exams. I doubt the value of exams very much. If you ask me, it's a sort of holy grail of education that we work towards exams and diplomas. What does a diploma mean? In a lot of cases, not so much. But that's a different subject. Now, here, they have to give this presentation. They have to give the business plan in a written form. And that will be evaluated by people from industry, some of our own academic staff. And so I'm always indifferent. I had only a part-time professorship. I was working as a management consultant, so I'll be reorganizing companies. But they also started my own company. And we had 12 or 20 people at the end when I sold it. So I'm also an entrepreneur. So it was always in different positions when I was doing this. Now, this is only half the story. Because the other half is that one of our partners, this is a management consultancy firm, Roland Berger, a German firm, and they have a chapter in Amsterdam. They provide young consultants who act as coaches to these teams. So you have teams of two or three, sometimes four people, sometimes also one person who starts a company. And they are guided through this whole process by these youngsters. Now, why does Roland Berger do that? They say it's a prestigious company. They say we get these children from very good families. They have never had hunger in their life. They had one, he told me now, he had a girl who was 26, had a PhD in philosophy, and she played with the National Youth Orchestra, and she was in the Olympic ice hockey team. And I said, well, I'm going to do with a person like this. They're simply too good, and they have to see the real world. Now, if you work with a startup company, you definitely see the real world. That's to say, that, if I may say, is that you see the shit of the world, and the hard work and the sweat and everything. So it's a very good experience for them to get to know a little bit about the real world, and not this fancy world in which they grew up, which is not true of all of them, of course. And they get this way, these students get very nice expertise, and they benefit from the network of people. They say, I know someone who can help you, or I can ask in the company and someone, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So it's very effective. Mass organizations. Now, the foundation, I've already mentioned it, where the sponsors are a member of, and put in some money, not only for dinners, also for PR. We have a website, and this is basically the picture. You see Ernst & Young. This is my section, my group of boards, because I'm retired. Financial Administration, Arnold Sietzmeyer is a patent officers, they know everything about intellectual property, and tell the students about it. This Bennis is the Marketing Bureau, Rabobank. Then we have a legal advice company, which is mainly corporate law, which is important. And of course, Roland Berger themselves. And then we don't do just give the course. This is the course, but we also coach him. I remember this. And we give a lot of services afterwards. When they're ready, it's like family. They're part of the group. And we see them again. We invite them again for drinks. On the final day, which we have twice a year, when these students, they present their business plans, we invite all the alumni of the course, and many of them try to come, not only to see these new companies, but also to do some networking. It's all one big family. You can't say anyone is leading this. I can't say I was the leader of this. No, sort of collective leadership. It worked remarkably well. Now, as I was saying, it's just not an isolated court. It's part of a context, if you like, of a program in entrepreneurship. Now, my own feeling is that, of course, not every student wants to start his or her own company. But it cannot be that a student says, after leaving the university, I never heard about the possibility to start a company. So, if they say, I'm not in for it, that's fine with me. But if they're ignorant about it, then the university has done something terribly wrong. So, we made a cascade program, here it is, of education. We start with awareness programs. Because a lot of students have no idea that you can start a company or what a company is and so on. So these are very short programs, usually with a management game. You have a management game. Students like gaming nowadays. Well, who doesn't? Only the games become different if you get older. Anyway, they have this awareness program. Then they follow a course called here elementary education. Usually course also short, maybe 3 days. Because it's very difficult to get space in the curriculum, so very often they have to do it in their own time. And then if you ask too much, then of course they don't show up. If it is short, they are interested in it. This is a subject in the official curriculum for which they get academic credits. It's a 4-week course. What we do, we give them patents from the university and ask them to think about the company, to sort of work towards a company. And this was very interesting. There was one example, thousands again. Yeah, this is if this is a bit technical, but if you have a wing on an airplane and you would have little holes under the wing and apply a little bit of vacuum, then the drag of the wing in the air becomes less and it goes easier, you need less fuel. Now, they had a patent, it was proven, it has worked, but before you can apply such a technology to a plane, there is 20 years of regulation, so nobody did anything with that patent. So he gave the patent to the students and said, find something, think of something. And, you know, they came up with two things. One is that we have these windmills nowadays, very big ones, and the same technology applies to windmills. If you have a bit of suction, they go around quicker and they produce more energy than it takes to apply the vacuum. And the other one was in race cars, you have these, what do you call it, a spoiler in front of it, which also have the shape of a wing, and there you can apply it as well. So they have to play with this and use their imagination, and then to start searching whether this is a realistic possibility. But of course, the aim is not to get companies out of it, although sometimes it has happened. Now, and then, so you have to think about it. You come to a point, you can go left, you can go right. You can say, now, after all, I found it interesting, but this is not going to be my life. Okay, that's fine. But if it is, and then usually they do this course, writing it, they are ready to start it, what I was talking about. Once they have completed that, they have to go, you will go to an incubator, share accommodation. There's a whole train of activities afterwards. And it is beautiful. You've probably heard about this book that was translated into Russian about the third generation university. I described the case of the University of Cambridge, which is the fourth oldest university in Europe. It has the highest number of Nobel Prizes in the world, so the Cambridge people are not stupid, and they have many. Newton was a fellow of Cambridge University, and many other people. It's a fascinating city to walk through. They'll say, you know, this house there, that's where Newton had his lodgings. It is as if they are still alive. So it is very high tech, high science, no question about it. At the same time, they've set up a lot of facilities for techno startups, and also facilities for selling know-how that is generated by the university itself, which is a different subject altogether. If you would make an aerial photograph, you would see the old city within the walls, with some university buildings, you know, they have these very beautiful buildings over there, in the middle of it. Then you see on a wider circle some newer institutes after the Second World War. And then beyond that, all the one after the other, the science park or technology park or whatever they call it, where these new enterprises are working. And they usually have very fancy building, fancy architecture. Some of these science parks are privately owned, investors who invest in the science park, and it's like an onion, every time there's another layer around it. And that is, in my view, the modern university. I hope that talks will move into that direction. You do big science on the one side, very good publications, top journals, if you can, a Nobel Prize, but it will take you 30 years at least and a lot of money to do that, so I don't think that's realistic. On the other hand, enterprises in parks around you and the central of new industrial activity. And this is what this cascade model is going for. Well, let me finalize, sum it up, the conclusions about actually why I'm giving this talk, not to promote entrepreneurship and techno status, because in a hidden way I've done that, of course. but what is innovative about this lecturing? So here, the goal is not an exam. They don't do this for a bit of paper. They do it for a concrete subject which you can use in practice, and they learn by doing, not because we tell them what it is like and so on. They learn by doing. And I think this is the the center point of what we call the new learning. At this university, we are setting up an institute for the new learning, with learning going to change. Learning is very much the way we do it now. Someone who knows everything, standing in front of a class, and people who are ignorant sitting in the benches and making notes. I don't want to be offensive, but that's basically the model that we have used 2 million years. And it is very ineffective in learning. And what is much more effective is you give small teams a task. In Finland, they're turning down all the primary schools that are broken down, and they create new ones without classrooms, but spaces where pupils can work together. And one thing that appeals very much to me, and it will also appeal to you, because we asked students of 14-year-olds to build a drone. Well, you know, a drone is sort of mini helicopters, and write the manual in French. And you think, how can people do that who have never studied French and who never almost don't know what a drone is? And then 3 weeks later, they have a drone and they have a manual in French. It is amazing what people can do if you give them challenging tasks. Now, they don't do it alone. The teachers have not disappeared, but they're not teachers anymore. They're coaches. And they go to them and say, I have a problem. How do I find this rotator? You say, okay, I can give you some ideas. Or move a little, whatever you do. So they're coaches and not teachers. So this is very much what we do here too. They do it themselves, they have their own problem, and we help them to solve the problem. Now, multitude of activities, not just lab works or lectures, and say there's this coaching activities going on. The lectures are from industry, not from the university. I was hardly allowed to speak there. I said, yeah, come on, that's crazy. Then they say, okay, you may give the introduction, but not more than 5 minutes. Well, all right, there we go. Experienced guest speakers, and the guest speakers, yeah, I haven't mentioned this yet, but we do this in an afternoon, so at 5 o'clock everybody gets tired. So what we then do, we give them a glass of beer from this contribution, and might be a good suggestion, you can talk to the rector about that, but maybe you can imitate it. It's very popular among students, I can tell you that. And then we invite a successful student from our university who started his own company, and they're going to tell their own story. So we have role models. And then, because if I tell them how to do it, it doesn't work, you know, too far away. But if you have a boy or a girl who is 5 years older or 10 years older, and say, you know, I was in this university, I was sitting in the same bench as you sit here. And then I started doing this and started doing that. Then the message is, I did it, you can do it too. And it's very powerful. Well, we have PR just for this course, for this subject. I've never seen it before in universities, but they had stickers all over the universities because it's different from the normal curriculum, so you have to ask attention for it. And we're running it like a company, really. Very much networking activities, cocktails, drinks. We have at a pub, and students can come there. They have to pay their own beer, of course, but it was always full. They always like it very much. Networking was very strong. I once was asked, I got a mail from someone says, do you know a notary who can make a draft of the statutes and who's not too expensive? So I sent some suggestions back. And then within 2 hours, I was very surprised, I got my own email back, because they forward to groups. You know, they get my mail, they forward to 10 people, but I'm also on that list, so I get my own email back, and then it comes. So it was spreading in no time all over the place. I was very surprised by this, how fast it goes. Collective leadership, and then of course the coaches. And finally, not an exam, but a presentation. You can say what I say about exams. A lot of people don't like that, of course, but I will give you one example. It's purely theoretical. Suppose you have an IT company, right? You have 50 people there. And there's a vacancy. And there are 2 candidates left. And both girls are equally clever. They're totally good in IT, they representative, everything you like. There's only one difference between them. The one has been 100% in IT since studies and since work practice, and the other one has spent 20% on philosophy courses and 80% in IT. My question is, who would you hire? The second. The one with the philosophy. Yeah? The one with the practice. Yeah, but philosophy is not practice. So one has done, imagine, has done only IT courses at the university, only information technology. And the other one has done 80% courses in information technology and 20% a course in philosophy. So who of the two would you hire? Would you, anyone? The one with the philosophy, that's what everybody says. So what's the value then of a diploma? Because you hire the girl who had done the philosophy because she has a good talk about why she did philosophy, and then you think this person has done much more thinking than just following some IT courses, and therefore she will be more worthwhile for my company. So it is the pitch of that girl that convinces you to hire her and not the diploma. Now think about diplomas. There's a typing error that takes me off. The curse does not stop when it's over, but as I said earlier, we're beginning. And, all academic input is very limited. I must say I had a fight with the rector of my university to get academic credits for this course, because a lot of people say it's not scientific education. I said, of course it's not scientific education, but if you define a university as an institute that only gives scientific education, then you're doing the wrong thing. And in addition, you also have here, you have language courses, and you get credits for it. What's academic about it? It's just a language course. You learn how to translate, how to speak another language. Nothing scientific about it. So we do teach our students some skills, and then why not this? No, that is basically my presentation. If anyone wants to comment or ask questions. Yes, I will. I have to give you a microphone.
Ideas for business plan is both from enterprises or from home.
Is it good for enterprises or is it good for their own learning? That's what you ask. Yeah. Well, it is the idea is that students start their own company. So it's good for the economy because you get another new company. And I would say, yeah, they certainly learned from it, but in a more practical way. It's not like a theoretical physics or mathematics where you really have to, or philosophy where you have to use your brain to understand it. It's more of a practical level. And it prepares you for a very special role in life. And I think we need many more people who have their own company and who start new economic activities. Because it's very simple. You have a company, it is successful, it is growing, it gets more people, more people, more people. Then it reaches a certain level, which we call maturity. It doesn't grow anymore because the market is satisfied already. We don't sell mobile phones at the moment because everybody has already one. So the market is saturated, the company is stable. And what is it going to do then to increase profit? Not growth, but cost reduction. So they become clever in reducing the cost and throwing people out. Now, this is not so bad, as long as they're new companies where people can start working. And this is actually how you know better as economists than I do. So I think it's very important that we have this. But it is also important from a university point of view, because if you want to compete in the academic work, world and be attractive for students and for let's say deep scientists, that you have to be good in three activities, which is education, research, and also this selling the know-how that's generated in university.
And another question. You said that in your group 30 students, and in English you have 30 business plans. Can work students, maybe 2, 3, 5 students, make one business plan?
Yes, can more students do one business plan? We often have teams. They're almost always with the two of them, sometimes three. But there are students who do it alone, but not many. And we have also had teams of four students.
And
maybe
in this work, maybe some specialization. One student in finance, one student in marketing, and others.
We have a good example of that, that you have complementary disciplines in the team of the entrepreneurs. There was one team and they've been thinking about the fortunes people spend on getting a suntan in the winter, right? But here you'll have sun in the winter as well, so you don't need it, but where I live it's all grey and rainy and so on. So. Yeah, what you do, you can go to a sauna, you can go to some sunny island. It's all very expensive and impractical. And then they said, well, actually, you take a shower in the morning, so there you start naked. So we make an instrument with four ultraviolet beamers, and while you toddle around, you also get a nice suntan at the same time. Now, that was not as easy as it looks like, because there you stand with your feet in the water, and here is this lamp with 240 volts. If it breaks or something, then you're charcoal. So it's not exactly what you like. It is also a suntan, but a bit too much of it. So they had a team. Now, one of these boys, that's why I'm telling the story, was an industrial designer, and he got the idea and also the form of it. And the other was an electrical engineer, and he got all these certificates from the well, we have these licensing bureaus that they have to give approval before you can bring it to the market because it is then safe and so on. He did all that. So with the two of them, they did a fine job and they sold all of them, each for about 3,000 euro, and many of them to Russia actually, despite the fact that you have also some in the Any.
So I would like to ask a couple of questions regarding this that cascade model of your soul. So there is the preliminary stage where all the students got this awareness of this program. Well, and then they got this elementary education. So does it compulsory for them? And if so, do this elementary part propose this business planning part already, or it's kind of a little bit later thing for them?
No, the business plan is the top of it. So, of course, they can also, if they have a good idea, they can come directly to the writing a business plan course. But many of them they go through this whole line. Now I must confess that it is my dream, it is not the reality of my faculty, because it was very difficult to get new subjects as a compulsory part of the program. Because if I want to throw my subject in 1 week, then we have to take out your subject of 1 week, which you won't like. So it's always very difficult to get space in the curriculum. But anyway, some faculties did it. The awareness programs we set up ourselves, and they found it fun. They would come in the evening and sometimes on a Saturday, and we do that. And this was just an elective, so there's always space for elective courses, and you get academic credit for it. And if you like it, you can do it, otherwise you choose something else. And this was also, of course, was an elective. This was not a part of the obligatory part of the course.
So, can I have a couple more questions?
Yeah, go ahead. Nice.
As soon as they have this business plan programmers, well, they can choose it. Where do they get the ideas for this business plan? Is it ideas from the universities or is it their own ideas? And well, a second question, so regarding your example about the the wing plane, the wing of the plane. So, was it these rights were distributed directly for them, and they were separated from the first owner completely?
The ideas can come from everywhere, but most of them they come from students themselves, and they pick it up and they do a technical end of term project. You think, hey, if we modify it a bit, we can make a product that we can sell. But I've also had students, and they were third-year students, and there were two friends. They said they were already good friends at the grammar school level, and then they decided to study in Delft Technical University with the explicit aim to start a company. So even before they enrolled, they had already decided, we go there to find a subject for a company. And they'd be looking around, they found something and they were very happy. And it was a company. How successful it became, I don't know. It gets lost. So usually it is their own ideas. The example of the suction in wings in, how do you call it? Aerodynamic structures, I don't know what you call it exactly. That was a painting by the university, so it was a university project. Then some lecturer or staff member gets a patent, but the patent will be owned by the university, not by the person. If you join a technical university, you have to sign a declaration that whatever patent you will acquire will be owned by the university. If you join Gazprom in their research department, they will also ask you to sign. So every company does this because, you are inventing something in their time for their place, so it's logical that they get the proceeds. Fortunately, in some cases, our university forgot to ask them. But the boy of the 400 million, there's an interesting story maybe. You have a lot of objects at sea, windmills. Oil production platforms, and you see these big platforms, you know, with the helicopter deck and everything. They're for exploration, not for production. If they are for production, they're very small, but they need to be serviced. So someone goes there with the ship, puts the ship aside, let's say the windmill, climbs a stair on the windmill, opens some door with a backpack of tools, and then does the servicing, whatever, and comes out. Now, that is all very fine if it is a nice weather, but if it's flat, very often it is not. And then he had an example of they were drilling in Sakhalin, and I think the level of it was 4 or 6 meter high waves. Now, you're not going to stand in the front of a grab the ladder and see the ship sinking in. So, said, what can we do about it? Now, then he was thinking about the flight simulators in which they train pilots. You know, you sit in something that resembles very precisely the cockpit of a plane. It is on hydraulics, and you steer it, and you feel how the plane reacts. That once being in one of these, it is amazing how realistic it is. And the hydraulics is very quick. Although it's a very heavy thing, if I put that on the front of a ship. Then he had an instrument that could detect whether the waves are coming up or going down. And of course the reaction or the movement of the ship is a reaction to the waves. And there's a lot of time in between. I mean, electronically you can do it in nanoseconds and the ship will rise in seconds, so you have a lot of time. You predict how the ship is going to work and you do a feed forward to this deck. So this deck makes all kinds of funny movements against the ship. But it stays almost free in the sky, while the ship makes all kind of funny movements, and it's easy to walk over. Now, that was a nice idea. When I heard it for the first time, I thought, this is never going to work. He was experimenting, and he got money from Shell, because this testing and everything cost him a lot of money. You have a ship there with the crew, and they wait 2 weeks to get the guy on the board, and maybe they have to wait another week before he can get off, and so on. So it is very expensive, also very dangerous. In Sakhalin, if you fall in the water, I think they can pick you up in 3 minutes, or otherwise you're frozen dead. So there's a lot to it. And they allowed him to experiment, and he had enough results to collect money and to have five or six ships, and they were doing fine, and then he sold it for 500 million. So yeah, it was an idea that came to the guy. I don't know where he got it from. Maybe a friend told him on the bar, said, you know, this is a problem I heard from someone who had an accident. That's how ideas start. I was saying that there is a big difference between techno starters and students who have an idea to bring it to the market, and the university who has knowledge of itself and patents and so on, and who sell it. And therefore you need special structures. The best is in Louvain in Belgium, which is a very old university. They have a bureau that has a monopoly on selling the know-how for that university. And they don't get paid by the university, it's just a group of about 40, 45 people, but they get a percentage. So if the university, if they sell know-how on behalf of a university department, what they do, they take 7.5%. The university itself also gets 7.5%, and the 85% go to the department. Now, then the person who has done the invention, they can get a bonus, but never more than 1 year's salary. And here you have pharmaceutical projects go also in the hundreds of millions, so 1 year's salary is nothing. And in addition, most people don't ask for it because you pay a lot of taxes and it doesn't help you very, very much. So that is a very different structure for selling know-how. They're all the time in at least 3 or 4 battles on intellectual property rights. They have very high qualified specialists to do these battles. So that's what you do if you sell know-how as a university. But it's a substantial amount of income that the university gets from these activities. If they have 45 people, well, you can work out what the salary is, and that's 7.5% of the total, so you can work out how much the university gets. So, that is the idea. No, there was one more question.
Sorry?
Not. Have we finished?
Yeah, but I just one more.
You're
sorry for that.
No, not sorry at all.
Okay, short one. So you talked us about those advisory from the business who participate in the student project as the advisory team. And well, I can understand well the reason why this huge consultant company from Big Four or so want to participate in a lecture or two. But what is the reason for them to participate in such a long process of collaborating with student project teams?
Okay. A very short answer to that question, and the answer is fun. It's just great fun if you coach a group of students to become a company, bring a product on the market. I would almost say it's like an addiction. It's a nasty to stop with it. Of course, at a certain point, you go different ways, but it is very motivating to stay with it. And then people are not counting like, you know, I work from 9 to 5 and after 5 o'clock I sit behind the television set. No, they're very lively people who like to do this. I did a lot myself, and then the student has a problem, you say, okay, meet me tonight. They say, yeah, I'm busy tonight. I say, okay, meet me at 11 o'clock at some pub in Delft. All hours and all places, but that's how you get it off the ground. It's very motivating, and if you do it with a team of these companies, as I was telling, we all know each other now very well. It's all like family, it is very nice. But it's difficult to set up. I suggested to do it here as well, but there are already some processes. But it's not just you can call a couple of companies and say, ah, good idea, we'll send someone tomorrow. That's not how it works. You really have to do it. Anyone else?
Oh, you have a
Dear Haran listener, I'm sorry for my English language, but I say next. First of all, I want to say thank you very much for your important and interesting for us lecture. Because in our class auditorium, students, our students and teacher, I think that your lecture is a result of your scientific experience. It is very interesting. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. And as for your English, I wish my Russian was a tenth of of your English. Okay. So
Hello, Professor Serrin, Khoda, Bedant, thank you for your lecture. My name is Olga Smolichuk, PhD in history. So my question concerns maybe the question of the previous state model and the corporate responsibility, because when I hear the entrepreneurship, I have an idea in my mind that it should somehow be connected with the impact of that business plan which students make. So my question is, does the Center of Corporate Social Responsibility in the Netherlands, MPO, participate in consultancy or make some consultancy or explain this plan?
Oh, how did you like Maastricht?
I think here once.
No, but you pick up your Dutch in Maastricht. I can hear from your accent.
It's maybe because of my
French.
But I studied in Amsterdam.
Ah, you studied in Amsterdam. No, Maastricht was, of course, was a French city mostly. And then when I went to university, in the upper class families, they would only speak French. In Maastricht, which I think is very civilized, don't you think so? No, I don't know about the Center of Corporate
Social Responsibility. MPO Netherlands.
I have to look it up. I don't know. Well, no doubt they have consultancy activities, because that's what all these institutions. Is it part of the Ministry of Economic Affairs? Or?
Yeah.
They probably have some consultancy.
My question is.
The coaching they're chosen for their business experience,
and in
a very broad sense. But if we would have an issue about social responsibility, we would ask someone as a guest lecturer to talk about it. Absolutely, that is very flexible. We can all arrange it ourselves as we like. But then he would also come at 5 o'clock.
Well,
then I would say, спасибо большое.